Thank you for the blessing that you gave us when you gave us Mike and his family. We ask your hand upon him now as he gives your word to us. Guide his thoughts, guide his lips, that what he speaks will be directly from you, so that we may take what he speaks into our hearts, into our lives, and into the lives of those around us. In Jesus' name we ask and pray. Amen.
Well, good morning. I'm going to do this sermon entirely in the voice of Moses. That was pretty impressive, and I like that you carried it on to the sermon or to the prayer accidentally. Dear God. Oh, dear God. Well, we are going to continue our time in Matthew 5, and we're going to bite off a big chunk today. We're going to do all of verse 4. But these Beatitudes are not to be rushed through when we want to see what God has for us in them. So I hope you guys don't mind. We'll more than likely take most of these one at a time just so we can see, first of all the truth that God has for us contained within these just few short words, but also to see how they play with each other and how they interlock with each other, like we talked about last week, like gears and a cog, kind of just how they'll fit together and how one can really help drive another. And so last week we began with a brief introduction to the Sermon on the Mount as a whole, and then to the Beatitudes specifically. And I pray that our time of recap right now will help us to understand that what God has for us in these Beatitudes is really calling for us for something, if we were truly honest, we're terrible at, which is self-denial. We could think about how hard self-denial is in many aspects of our lives. I know for me, opening up the freezer and I see that thing of ice cream there, that's one way, and maybe that would be sinful or not sinful, I suppose, depending upon my heart. But if we were honest with ourselves, we're pretty not so good at self-denial, because often we have placed ourselves so much on the throne, our own enjoyment, our own fulfillment, all sorts of things can come into play when we think about what we want and what we get and what we need out of life. So my prayer is that as we move through these Beatitudes, we will see the self-denial that God is calling for. And again, I really wish I could say I planned this with the Habakkuk series, but I did not. But it's just amazing to me as we closed our time in Habakkuk this morning, how Habakkuk was entirely reliant upon God, how he was living through his faith. He, as the message paraphrase was saying, Habakkuk, in the face of all those terrible troubles he was to see, his bones turned to water. He couldn't have strength to stand on his own. And that how he was living entirely on faith. And I think in a similar sense, that's what Jesus is doing in here and giving us these Beatitudes. He's demonstrating to us what it means to live by faith. And so what we'll look at, I hope, this morning is that we'll see that these Beatitudes are calling for self-denial, demanding, really, and then calling for that in the life of a Christian. And so last week we laid the groundwork for the Sermon on the Mount, and then we also talked about the Beatitudes specifically, and that in the Beatitudes we have a revealing of key characteristics that God approves in his people. And these are characteristics that God not only approves, but he also graciously gives, indicating his approval. And like I promised before, we will all at some point or another in this sermon series, whether it's in the Beatitudes or into the Sermon on the Mount, we all at one some point or another will be offended. I know it was tough to wrangle with what it meant to be poor in spirit, because we often do like to think of ourselves, because God speaks about salvation as we were bought with a price. And Christ Jesus paid for us with a price. So there is an imago Dei, an image of God worth to us. But when we think about our spirit, our life apart from Christ, we are, as we were instructed last week by God's word, we're beggarly poor when it comes to our spirit. How we are entirely and completely in need of Christ to provide us any sort of worth. And so when we think about this, we see that these are requirements, so to speak, or really they're characteristics that God not only approves, but he also graciously gives us these characteristics. He wouldn't ask us to do something that he wouldn't then also empower us to do. And I think it takes an act of God's Spirit, us being in alignment with his Holy Spirit, to see us as beggarly poor in spirit. And to deal with the condition of our own spirit honestly, to say, boy, apart from Christ, what did I have to offer? What did I have to lay at the foot of Christ to go, here, take this, this is worth so much. But no, it's not that way. We come to God, we come to Him, basically, in essence, as that Rock of Ages hymn would say, nothing in my hands I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. We come to Him from that standpoint. So the first four Beatitudes actually almost reveal the error of our superficial, self-centered living that we all struggle with on one level or another. So I want to read these first four all at once just so we can hear this. We'll do a really quick recap on blessed are the poor in spirit, and we'll move on to verse 4. But Matthew 5, verses 3 through 6, actually, yeah, we'll read 3 through 6. Read, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. And I read this summary of those first four Beatitudes, and I found it helpful. The quote begins, they help us to admit our spiritual poverty, to mourn over sin and oppression, and to humbly seek spiritual fullness, end quote. So when we think about this, those first four Beatitudes demonstrate for us an attitude and characteristics that we not only get, but that we also must cultivate. It's almost like God gives us a seedling. I think hopefully last week He planted that seedling of being poor in spirit, so that when we meditate on that and when we come across other sections in Scripture which echo that sentiment, we can cultivate that seed and we can get better at thinking in those regards, because this is something that Christ has called us to. So not only Rock of Ages, but if we think about the hymn, In Christ Alone, also echoes this, which sings, in Christ alone my hope is found, He is my light, my strength, and my song. Or we can think about a more recent hymn, which is All I Have is Christ. And that goes, Alleluia, praise the Lord, Alleluia, all I have is Christ, Alleluia, Jesus is my life. So what we're doing when we come together and we sing songs, we're singing praises of what God has done for us. And so many of these hymns help us to understand in a different way many of these characteristics that the Beatitudes are calling us for. And again, like we talked about last week, these Beatitudes were a lot probably easier to understand maybe for the original audience. Because when we think about this original audience, when you think about the Pharisees, the Sadducees, even the scribes to a certain extent, they weren't spiritually poor. Their self-examination was, we are spiritually nailing it. We are totally following these 800 and some odd expansions of the commandments of God, and we're earning our spiritual favor. We are meriting God's righteousness by what we do. So when Christ said that first Beatitude last week, blessed are the poor in spirit, that probably hit the ears like, poor in spirit? Are you kidding me? I've got this thing nailed. I'm checking off 800 of these bad boys. I've got it. I'm good to go, God. And so for them, it was maybe a little bit more palpable and more tangible for them to see this poverty of spirit. But for us, I think we can come to it from a similar perspective, but instead of our spiritual righteousness or our own righteousness, our rule following that we bring to almost self-identify our worth, we can come to it from a position of self-sufficiency. I'm an island. I can stand. I've got this all figured out. We can come to this from a position of basically feeling like we've got it all figured out, and what the Bible adds to my life is just like frosting on the cake. Not understanding that the water, flour, baking soda, and all that is coming from God. I don't even know if we bring the pan, let alone the frosting and the sprinkles. And so I think what it's going to be easier for them to apply it to their day spiritually, but for us, we can think about it coming from our standpoint of placing self-esteem above all, self-worth above all, self-sufficiency above all. But I think what we saw in Habakkuk, and I think what Jesus is expanding on even here, is that no, we're entirely, utterly dependent upon God for our everything, for our righteousness, for our forgiveness, and even for our sustenance. Because Habakkuk was even saying, golly, if my fields are empty, if my barns are empty, if there's nothing even in my flock, I'm rejoicing in your righteousness, God. And so I think that's kind of what we're going to see in these Beatitudes. I pray that they strike us in the same spot that they did in Jesus' day, with the exception that it's more based upon our idea of performance, our performance-laden society. So these Beatitudes identify those gracious gifts of God that indicate His approval, not requirements for works that merit His approval. And that is why last week we looked at, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And that when we acknowledge our total and complete and entire dependence upon God for everything, for righteousness and sustenance, we are gaining an understanding of what our Lord had for us in this Sermon on the Mount. That we are blessed, which really means we're approved, we're favored, we're fortunate, we're privileged, as we recognize that spiritually we are beggarly poor outside of Christ. And we think about our spirit as that immaterial by means we have an intimate relationship with the perfect and righteous God. And that spirit is utterly poor and bankrupt apart from Christ. And it is that utter and complete dependence upon Him that is now accomplished and that brings about salvation. It's that aspect of repentance, really. And I think that that's what He's calling on for our Beatitude this morning as well. So nothing in my hands I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. With that said, let's stand and read our text for this morning, which can be found in Matthew 4. Please stand with me as we read God's word. Matthew 5, verse 4 says, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Let's pray. Gracious, comforting Lord, thank you, Father, that in our mourning, and as we'll see, Lord, in our worldly sorrow and in our godly sorrow, you provide comfort. And Father, help us to see what you have for us in this short beatitude. As Jesus was instructing all those within earshot, but specifically His disciples that were at His feet as He sat in the position of a rabbi as their teacher, as the one that they were following, Lord, He instructed them in these brief statements that carried so much weight. Thank you that they were preserved and that we can now study them. And not only study them, Lord, because we don't want to be puffed up with empty knowledge, but we can move that head knowledge into heart knowledge as we operate in our lives, as we are the hands and feet of Christ to our church, and as we reach out into our community. Father, I pray that as we leave here this morning, we are people associated with what you mean by to mourn. And I think we've got one part of that down pretty well, Lord, but help us to see the godly sorrow and help us to mourn for what mourns you. In Jesus' precious name, amen. You may be seated. So I asked Sharon to read that text from Luke because I think it demonstrates for us one of the aspects in which we can mourn. And it was one of the ways, one of the rare instances in the Bible in which we see Jesus mourning. I think everyone's favorite Bible verse consists of two words, John 11:35. Does anybody have that one memorized? Jesus wept, right? We love that verse because it's short and where we got it nailed to two words. But that's one of the other instances when our Lord mourned. And when we think about what's encapsulated in those two small words, the mourning of our Lord, that's a profound two words. But the section I had Sharon read for us, and the section really sets the stage for Jesus making His final entrance into Jerusalem, or thinking about and talking about that last moment of Him coming to that city. And we've got basically Jesus weeping over Jerusalem. And that helps essentially set the stage for this morning, where we talk about what it means to mourn. And I think Jesus has given us one really good example of that, because here Jesus is approaching the city of Jerusalem for a final time. Earlier, He had wished to gather the children as a hen gathers chicks under its wings. He wanted so much for them to hear the gospel, to hear that He was the Messiah, the anointed one that we talked about from Habakkuk, that the Christ to come, the Savior to come. He wanted to gather them under His wings like a hen gathers chicks. Now here He is mourning because they had rejected Him. And this is that same city that welcomed him with amazing singing, Hosanna to the Son of David, who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest. And now here they are basically saying, crucify him. He knew that was coming. And he was mourning the fact that 40 years down the road, after his death, because he's God and he knew it was coming, Jerusalem would fall under siege of the Romans, under their leader Titus. And over 1 million Jews would fall in that lengthened siege. He knew that it wasn't merely their physical death that would be the worst part of it. They had rejected the one who was promising them salvation. All of those rules that they had tried to keep, the Pharisees and Sadducees, were just a means to some nebulous end. Jesus was the means to the real end. And he was mourning the fact that, yeah, he was mourning that they would have to go through physical grief and suffering. But we all know that that physically comes to an end in eternity, and he was truly mourning for them rejecting him as Savior. And I think that starts to lay the groundwork for us in terms of how we are and how we are enabled to mourn in really the deepest sense. And it's in that sense of mourning that helps us apply the second beatitude to our lives. Because we have to be honest, mourning is not a concept that we are unfamiliar with. When we think about mourning, we're often really well-equipped and maybe even well-practiced at mourning for many things. And this is actually, this isn't a bad thing. These are just ways that we mourn. We can mourn the death of loved ones. We can mourn a national tragedy, as we did last week when we thought about our brothers and sisters in Christ who did not deny the name of Christ at the peril of their own life for that shooter. We can mourn for so many things. We can mourn for the thousands of babies each day that are aborted. We can mourn over sin. And that's a good thing. I think I even just jumped categories, mourning over sin. But we can mourn over the real loss of life, but then what I think he's calling us for is that mourning over sin. And that basically, that is a right response. We should mourn. When you lose a loved one, you mourn. That's natural and that's real. And I really think that that's part of what was going on in John 11:35. Jesus came, Mary and Martha are distraught, the Jews with them were mourning, and when he sees that, he weeps. We know he wasn't weeping over Lazarus' death because he knew he would be raising him to life. He's mourning with them, understanding that there's a real loss. We also know, and when he was mourning over the city, that he wasn't mourning over his own personal sin because he had none. So we have this idea of mourning. The right response is our worldly sorrow. We can have that response, but we shouldn't dwell on that. But I would argue that we're quickly become a culture that's being desensitized to that type of mourning. Our president even said it when he talked about that shooter in Oregon. It's almost becoming, we're losing that response that just hits us in the gut. Boy, I hope we don't lose that. But the more and more we're confronted with the evils of our world, the more we are becoming desensitized to violence. Whether it's through movies, whether it's through video games, or whether it's through real life reported to us on national television. And if we're not becoming desensitized to it, we actually are learning to avoid mourning in many ways as well, and they are often very destructive ways. We can do something as simple as just reverting to entertaining ourselves away from mourning, quickly pulling out our handheld devices and burying ourselves in our Facebook updates or a video game or something like that. Or we can turn to drugs and alcohol to take away our mourning. So this sermon is not against mourning, but this sermon is about what we have to recognize what's going on here spiritually as well as worldly. Martin Lloyd-Jones states in his commentary in this passage, "The whole organization of life, the pleasure mania, the money, the energy and enthusiasm that are expended in entertaining people are all just an expression of the great aim of the world to get away from this idea of mourning and this spirit of mourning." End quote. And I would argue we are in the midst of perhaps an unparalleled time in history where we do everything we can to avoid mourning as if it's a bad emotion. Well, it isn't an emotion to avoid, and perhaps we can learn a lot about our current position if we mourned about what was relevant. If we mourned about that loss of life. If we mourned about the sin we see not only in the world but especially in ourselves. So my prayer is that we get an idea of what this mourning is, and that by the end of our time this morning, we are people not marked by morbidness, but by a real sense of what it means to mourn. Not an artificial, downtrodden exterior, but that we have a proper understanding of mourning with the promise of comfort. This wasn't a scratch-off after mourning. You might get comfort and you might not. This is a promise. You will, you shall be comforted. So let us rest with that promise of comfort as well. And just as Jesus used a real fleshly emotion to elicit a spiritual teaching in the idea of spiritual poverty, here I believe he does the same. Because we could all resonate with poverty. In fact, Luke, in his accounting of the Beatitudes, leaves it just at that. The blessed are the poor in that first Beatitude. Identifying that utter dependency upon someone else for their sustenance helps identify that spiritual reality of blessed are the poor in spirit. So here I think he's doing the same thing, because we have a real human emotion, mourning, but he's also training us on how to mourn as God mourns. So this week we will see that, and I pray that again as we leave here this morning, we understand and we have a real understanding of what mourning is in a spiritual sense, in a spiritual reality. And that's what I believe Jesus was doing over Jerusalem. He was mourning a godly sorrow. He was mourning not merely the loss of life, but the loss of lives to the grave and beyond. That there's much more at stake here. This is basically also reminiscent of Jeremiah 9. Anyone that's spent any time in Jeremiah understands that I can refer to him as the weeping prophet, because in Jeremiah 9, verse 1 begins, "Oh, that my head were waters and my eyes a fountain of tears, that I might weep day and night for the slain of the daughter of my people. Oh, that I had in the desert a traveler's lodging place, that I might leave my people and go away from them, for they are all adulterers, a company of treacherous men." We hear Jeremiah there mourning over the loss of the daughters of his people, but also mourning over the fact that they were adulterers, company of treacherous men. That spiritual aspect of mourning, mourning over the sin that is present. Because we all know that sin leads to judgment. So when we read this beatitude, the selfless blessedness, hear that again, the selfless blessedness that we can hear and that this offers is that those who mourn will be comforted. Selfless blessedness. The less we are understanding, or the more we are understanding of ourselves, the more we're able to set ourselves aside and mourn for what mourns God. Just as Jesus mourned over the sin that led Jerusalem at large to reject him, so should we mourn over sin. And to establish that mourning refers to sin, we think of what our first response to sin should be. When we mourn over sin, we should not merely just mourn over the sin in our lives, but we should also mourn over the sin in the world as well. Jesus, of course, did not have to mourn over his personal sin. But he also mourned over sin in general. Because we are sinful people, the more proper we have an understanding of mourning, I think the more then we will mourn for what mourns God. And our proper response to sin should be, and it begins with the letter R, repentance, everyone's favorite practice in the spiritual realm, right? We love to look at all of our problems and our deficiencies in the face of God's perfection and his holiness, don't we? It's a fun thing to do. Tell me more how I'm wrong. I just want to be reminded of this. Oh, it hurts. It's painful. Because we know that when the Holy Spirit helps us get past one particular pesky sin, there's another one coming. There's an aspect of that that we should also be comforted, because we're being brought more into alignment of being like Christ. So to show you that I'm not making this up, please turn with me to 2 Corinthians 7. Second Corinthians chapter 7. I'll begin reading in verse 10. Verse 10 begins, "For godly grief produces a repentance that leads to salvation without regret, whereas worldly grief produces death. For see what earnestness this godly grief has produced in you, but also what eagerness to clear yourselves, what indignation, what fear, what longing, what zeal, what punishment. At every point you have proved yourselves innocent in the matter, So although I wrote to you, it was not for the sake of the one who did the wrong, nor for the sake of the one who suffered for the wrong, but in order that your earnestness for us might be revealed to you in the sight of God. Therefore, we are comforted. This tells us, especially beginning in verse 10, that there's a vast difference between worldly grief and godly grief. Godly grief produces repentance, which leads to salvation without regret. And what's our natural bent when we have an honest looking at sin? Isn't it a sense of guilt? And that's good. That's right, but we don't stay there. You can have salvation without regret. You don't dwell upon that past sin because it's been paid for by Jesus Christ. Don't stay there. Move towards rejoicing. Move towards being comforted. And ultimately, when you do that, what you're leaving behind in repentance is the dross on the top of the molten fire of refinement by the Holy Spirit. When metals are refined, the impurities rise to the surface, and after the metals are hardened, they're knocked off. Leave that stuff behind. Let the Holy Spirit do His refining work in you. Leave that stuff behind. Because there's going to be ample opportunity in the future for future mourning over sin. And also rejoicing. In fact, every time you no longer give in to that sin that God has provided you victory over, that's an opportunity for rejoicing. Yes, I didn't fall into sin again. Thank you, God. Normally, my knee-jerk reaction would have been to eat that whole carton of ice cream. I had a spoonful. Thank you, God. So rejoice over the victory He gives you. But earlier in this chapter, in 2 Corinthians, Paul is recounting his earlier letter to them about areas of sin, which is likely referring to 1 Corinthians, where he brought attention to many sins, both individual and corporate in nature, for this church. And in the paragraphs preceding what we read, we see that Paul was okay with making them grieve over their sin because grieving leads to repentance. Seeing that their grief, which he brought about by shining the light on sin, brought about repentance, causes him to rejoice. So godly grief produces repentance, and then that repentance can ultimately lead to rejoicing. Referring again to Martin Lloyd-Jones, he says at this point, "As I confront God and His holiness and contemplate the life that I am meant to live, I see myself in my utter helplessness and hopelessness," when we think about ourselves apart from Christ. We see then that in this beatitude we are to mourn about our poverty of spirit. We see also that, like this, we can see how that poverty in spirit can help us, drive us to mourning over sin. And again, not to leave us there. These beatitudes are connected. This should then be a cause for self-examination. I know thinking about the poverty of spirit last week led me to a lot of self-examination this past week. But at this beatitude, having us to mourn because we'll be comforted, when we think about mourning over sin, we can think again about self-examination. And maybe at the end of each day we could pause and think about what we have said. Think about what we have done. Maybe even think about what we have left undone that we should have done. And have that moment of repentance. Have that moment of mourning over our sin, but not staying there because we're promised also to be comforted. And I think about Paul in Romans 7 when he said, "Wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then I myself serve the law of God with my mind, but with my flesh I serve the law of sin." He mourns for his sin, but he doesn't stay there. He repents, he serves the law of God with his mind, and then he rejoices, offering thanks to God through Christ Jesus our Lord, so that he combats sin in his members and seeks to serve the law of God. He moves from mourning to rejoicing, and I think we could say he is comforted. Wretched man that I am. Where does he go from there? To rejoicing. Thanks be to God for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Mourning leads to repentance. Repentance leads to rejoicing. And rejoicing leads to being comforted. I've titled today's sermon, "Good Grief," because I do like Charles Schulz and the Peanuts, but hopefully this mourning shows us what true good mourning can be. realized when I saw that I hadn't even told you the title of the sermon yet. So let's start over. So it is in hope that we have comfort. We've talked about mourning leading us to repentance. We've talked about repentance leading us to even rejoicing over the sin. And that rejoicing can lead us to comfort. And Paul goes on in Romans 8 to talk about, and he says in Romans 8, the suffering of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. Paul informs us that even creation is groaning earlier in this section. Almost in a sense, mourning, groaning, creation groaning, in the bounds of sin. And in verse 23 of chapter 8, he says, and not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we eagerly await for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies, for in this hope we were saved. There's this groaning inwardly over sin, but there's not staying there, not lingering there. I think that's when we have that morbidness. That's where we have the downtroddenness. That's where sin has had that control in your life. Because the devil is a liar. He will tell you that that sin is worth it. Oh, you're going to feel so good when you do this. Just do it. And then the second you do it, he condemns you. Because he is a liar. He tells you, oh, why did you do that? You are so dirty. You're nasty. God can't do anything with you now. And Christ is telling us, and especially Paul here, he's saying, don't stay there. Repent of that sin. And repentance is that beautiful act of turning from your sin, and not just away from that sin, because you'll find another one, but turning to God. I got to say, that's not my natural reaction. If I went by my natural reaction, I would turn from sin to something else to try to find relief. Why am I going to go? That's like saying to a teacher, cheated on this quiz. No, I'm going to try to get away with it in my natural sense, right? That's like telling God where you've gone wrong. But tell him because he already knows it. We've got a God who knows everything, who comforts you. He offers you comfort and rejoicing. So this repentance is we turn from our sin and we turn to God. Because in God you have relief. In God you have forgiveness. Mourning and you'll be comforted because of Christ and what he's done. Because of his perfect life. Because of his perfect sacrifice. Because of his promise of making all things new, including you and all the thorns and thistles on this earth. Don't stay there. Don't stay in grief and in mourning. Mourn for your sin, that's the right response. But move to the part where he talks about being comforted. So we hope, and in that hope we are comforted, because we know that just as we await the redemption of our bodies, which we all do, come Lord Jesus, but we also know that even our members, once we're saved, will no longer sin. Mourning with our members anymore. That sin that plagues you today won't in that glorious future. That's our hope. That's that shall be comforted in the complete sense. As we talked about last week, these Beatitudes are talking about the kingdom of God in both the present tense and the future tense, saying that it's a present tense real reality right now, but it will be fully consummated in the future. That you can have victory over sin now. Why? Because God's promised it. Why? Because you have the Holy Spirit living inside of you. But you'll experience that time in the days to come, in the life to come, in the future, new heavens and new earth, where you won't war with that sin anymore. Practice that now. Rest in that now. Rest in the reality of God's salvation. And what is this hope? Sticking with Paul in Titus 2:11, he says, for the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all people, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age, waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works. Don't stay in mourning. Mourn, that's the right response, but don't stay there. Realize the blessed hope. Realize where your comfort comes from. Rejoice in the fact that God has given you victory over sin. Move beyond rejoicing to being comforted. A real comfort. He's given you that real comfort. The promise of working on sin here and now and having victory over it, not believing the lie of the devil, but also the promise of the world to come, the new heavens and new earth, where all things will be as they should. So as we close, I wanted to share with you just a little story to help illustrate the differences between worldly and godly sorrow. It was either my second sophomore year or my first junior year of college. Can't quite remember. I had a lot of college in my undergrad. And this story will kind of explain why. But it was in that time when I was an RA in college, and I was completely on the throne of my life. I was living for me. There was not a decision I made that was, very rarely would I ever make a decision that did not amount to my happiness, quotation marks over happiness. If I got up for my noon class, I would go. There were a couple of final exams I didn't even go to because I knew there was no hope in me even doing well enough on that exam to pull that up to a passing grade. And I was completely living entirely for myself. And it came to the point where I got this dreaded letter from the Office of Financial Aid, which said that we're no longer going to help you finance your lack of ambition and your lack of maturity and your laziness. So you're going to lose your financial aid. And at this point, I'm going, all right, well, that means I'll be going home, which was dreadful to have to then face my parents. I would probably not even finish college because at that point I had no ambition. I had no clue really what I wanted to do with my life. But I knew I wanted to at least finish a degree. And so I went and talked to my manager, my boss as an RA, let him know, my hall director, said, I'm probably not going to be back in the fall because there's no way I'm going to be able to swing paying for college without financial aid, and I will be probably resigning from my position as an RA. And he went and talked to his boss, who was another good friend of mine, who was basically the director of residence life at Central Michigan University. And so she went and called me into her office. She said, Mike, I don't think that you're done here. She's like, you need to straighten up. You need to get your act together. Grow up. Play the man. Stop being an idiot. Stop being lazy. Stop being unambitious. Like, laid it out for me exactly how I needed to hear it. She's like, Kathy needs you to finish college. So at that point, I'm going, wow, I had worldly grief. I was sorry for, I'm going to lose my ability to be an RA. I'm going to lose my ability to finish my college. I have really made a hash of how could I ever get into another college? They're going to look at my transcripts and say, we add all these together, there's not even a 4-point grade point average. What are we going to do? At this point, experiencing worldly grief, she went to bat for me. She wrote a letter to the Office of Financial Aid and said, I'm going to watch him like a hawk. Will you please reinstate his financial aid? Do it probationary status, whatever you need to do. I kept all of her letters that she wrote to me over this, and I reread them as I was thinking about the story for today, and it's really interesting how that worldly grief came back to me. Like, what a hash, what a waste of money, of time. And I thought, do I have godly grief over that? Because that was sin. I wasn't saved at the time, which does not excuse it, by the way, but it does put a category over it. But I can now, as a Christian, saved by the precious blood of Jesus Christ, look back on that and go, God, I'm sorry for squandering those resources you gave me of time. I'm sorry for squandering the resources of my financial aid that paying off for years and years to come. I'm sorry for financing my laziness and the effect it had on my life. I can pray and ask God to forgive me for those sins now as a Christian. And I don't have to rest in that sorrow that I had over potentially losing my job. Long story short, wouldn't be here today if I didn't finish college, I would imagine. I don't think you guys would look at my bachelor's degree if I would have finished there and said, wow, we're going to bring this guy who can't even do well in underwater basket weaving? I mean, how hard is that? I wish that was a guy. I took almost every gym class there was to get the grade point average up. That wasn't one, but it was obviously a worldly repentance that I turned certain behaviors of my own around. But now I can look back on that and go, what a waste. And ask God to forgive me. And guess what? He does. And he can do that with your sin as well. And he has. And I know that was probably a shallow, superficial example, but we all have sin that should cause us to grieve and to mourn. And we have some sin too that's probably buried. And we've got a layer of wood, and then like a layer of stone, and then a layer of concrete, and a layer of steel, and then a layer of bulletproof titanium, all on top of it because we don't want to deal with it. But what God is saying, mourn for that sin. You shall be comforted. He can take the dirtiest, ugliest sin that you're trying to protect and take you from mourning to comfort. And in that, you can rejoice because it was Jesus Christ who provided that forgiveness for you. He can forgive a murderer. He can bring a rapist, a repentant rapist, into the kingdom. He can do marvelous things and does every single day. So don't hold on to that sin, that memory of that sin that still causes you worldly sorrow. Deal with it with your godly sorrow. Repent for that sin. Mourn for that sin because it was an offense to the perfect and holy God. But don't stay there. Move from there to repentance. Move from there to rejoicing, and move from rejoicing to comfort because you have hope. Not in and of yourself because we are spiritually poor, but because of Christ. He bought you for a price. Valuable price. An amazing price on the cross. And he didn't buy you so that you'd stay dwelling upon that mourning, but mourn and then be comforted. To close, I'd like to read from Revelation 21:4. And in this, we can read about the comfort that will be made perfect in the long-awaited new heavens and new earth, whereby Christ's precious blood all things will be made new. John says in Revelation 21:4, he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. So when you move from mourning to rejoicing, and from rejoicing to hope, which is comforting, rest in that fact that there's comforting here and now, and in an immeasurable way, comfort to be coming in the future. Let's pray. Comforting Lord, thank you for not leaving us knee-deep in the muck and mire of our lives and the sin of our lives. And Father, I'm so thankful that every time we tread to the edges of lightness where we dip a toe in darkness or we fall in, you are there to offer us forgiveness, to offer us repentance, to offer us rejoicing. And that's not our natural bent, Lord. We know that when we think about our sin, we stand often in that muck and mire, and that's where we dwell. But Lord, help us to see that blood-bought ladder that we climb out on your precious Christ sacrifice. And in there, in that sacrifice of Christ, in our identity as being found in him, as the adoption of sons that we wait for, we find forgiveness. We find healing. Healing that we need, Lord. Thank you. Thank you for the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Father, I pray that as we leave here this morning, those that are saved by you move from mourning to rejoicing regularly as part of their habit, maybe even each night as we examine our day. Shed more light on our sin and give more power and grant more repentance and trusting in you. And Lord, I pray that if there's anyone here that is not your child, that they've heard this morning and they lay bare their life before you. They say, I'm not going to try to merit salvation because it's been accomplished for me at the cross. I'm laying down my work and I'm trusting only in you, Christ. Father, it's in Jesus' glorious and precious name we pray. Amen.